I also wear the hearing aid I have, but I hardly ever do because this coffee machine drowns everything out of my ear.
I will do, is that better for?
Thank you. Thank you, don't you close the door?
It's fine, thank you, yes, thank you very much. So, can I, this is behalf, welcome everybody to Capital Wellbeing Board. Can I first ask if anybody has any declarations of interest that they'd like to make?
Council nominates Mr. Gavin to CWP.
I have a personal interest, Chair, and item 4B is I'm subject of a complaint by the person chosen in the court, so I will take the part in this.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask for any apologies for absence?
John Best. Councillor Davis. Craig Hopkinson, Paul Boyce, Dr. Sue Wells, Simon Banks, beautiful ladies from Health Watch, and Karen Howell, our Chief Superintendent in Castle.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Can I ask for the table to turn to the minutes, page 1 to 8. Just ask for any points of accuracy on clarification.
It may be that this exciting meeting in Liverpool, which we know not much about, is something to do with STP or OSP. The problem I think we've had, certainly as another committee was at, is that Graham spent some time explaining that here at the local level we'll deal with 80% of things because it's stuff we can stuff with capital. Projects that we can manage locally and really genuinely fit in with every will. And as I said at that meeting, the other 20% of the stuff might be the major reorganisation somewhere tootling along in the STP that we don't yet know about. Which there is another sort of universe at a higher level up there considering things which aren't yet reaching the probably councillors at this level. And well above the stratosphere for any members of the public, I suppose. And I can understand people being ill, as we can always all be ill. At various times when we've met and passed this health and wellbeing board, I've looked around the room, no offence to anyone, but a couple of years ago, as when the big chiefs came, if you forget the description, and I appreciate there's a certain amount of, I'm going to be very diplomatic here, a certain amount of fluidity in the management of some health institutions locally. And senior officers in the health service may have higher priorities than coming to the board, or our board. I'm going to get worried that as a health and wellbeing board, when we try to get people from the housing, the fire, the police, and all sorts of organisations in, discuss big issues and coordinate things, probably being overlooked, but our status is either being downgraded or ignored. And I hope we can, in consultation with colleagues, convey the message that if it was intended to be a meeting of senior leadership of the council, with Councillor Lewis and myself, opposition leaders, then are we being bypassed? Are we really being affected? Have we got the status of the people that bang heads together? If you'll forgive me, putting it in my terms.
Thank you, and I will certainly take that message back to all the members of the board on behalf.
Thank you very much. And I didn't mean to offend anyone, but I thought I could say.
Well, can I since Nesta has agreed to come and speak to us about one of those strands of work, asking Nesta to give us a bit of an update on the maternity work?
Yes. Simon was asking that there's a strategic highlight report that was prepared in January, and that can be shared with the board members following today, so we can send that on to you. But he wanted me just to raise some points with you in particular. So in terms of, there's been a local maternity system plan. So you've seen that in the report it says that it's the deadline's the end of January, just to confirm that has been submitted and it's gone in. So some of the key pieces of work is about the continuity of carer, and that feeds into another piece of work, which is an early adopter programme, where on Liverpool we are piloting one of the first pop-up midwifery-led units in Seacombe. And that's due to start on the 20th of March this year. The other piece of work that's happening is this is about maternity choice and being a pioneer. This is across Cheshire Merseyside, about having personalised maternity care budgets, and that work is progressing. They are notional budgets, so women won't be given the money for their maternity care, but they will have a notional budget and they're working through that. The baby box continues to be rolled out, and Simon was keen that I let you know that the Royal College of Midwives that they're about to do a statement of support for that, so that's really great news. So I think in our area we're seeing somebody leading the light, and also that community engagement initiatives that they're continuing as well. Some of the other things in children and young people in the paediatric. So expressions of interest have gone out to have advanced paediatric nurse practitioners, and there's some students on that, and some of them will be placed on Wirral as well, so we're getting that additional workforce coming up part of the Wirral. I think that was the bulk of what he wanted to pull out. We can share the update with everybody. It is January, but
the same way, and perhaps it could be updated from January. But does anybody have any questions?
Forget where I read it. I did write in a council document that described the new service in the children's centre and seeking of the birth report. But somewhere I read that it was the aimed at mothers who were likely to have any difficulties or complications, and therefore, have I got that wrong? Was it for every mother that wanted to do it, or were they going to check what might be best for them? Thanks, Mark.
We have Dr. Paul Cowden, who's the medical director, so perhaps I could ask you to think of this as a matter of conversation.
I've got a very loud Irish voice. You'll be able to hear me on the streets. The pop-up unit is a pilot with the support of our local trust, Wirral University Teaching Hospital, and midwifery led by the senior midwife at Wirral University Teaching Hospital. And it is for those women who are considered low risk. So any lady who would be deemed when they are booked in and with their antenatal history or their previous obstetric history is taken, or who have a coexisting medical condition, those ladies may be managed in a different way. So the ladies who are low risk, who have previous normal deliveries, who have no good coexisting morbidity syndrome or any coexisting they would be suitable for the birthing in Sweden. I think we need to applaud the work done, and this is a pioneering, piloting service within our area that we will consider for this. So I think we need to embrace it, see it as a good service for women locally, and what the outcomes are for it. But in terms of your question, it's low risk. So anybody who's had previous difficulty in labour or previous sections may not be considered for this. They would have to be looked at in a different way.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
I have a question, but it's not related to any of the four service areas listed with the item. It's more about the wider process on this, this one. Many of the councillors have received an email from a Frank McIntyre asking specifically regarding makes a number of points about the STP process, but also highlights what he refers to as a potential conflict of interest with Andrew Gibson. I'm just wondering what diligence is carried out by the NHS to ensure there is no conflict of interest, where there is, it's recorded and available for the public, so that people like Mr. McIntyre can see clearly what the role of various people in the process is.
I haven't heard about that letter, so I'm not in a position to respond directly. If I would be in your direction around the conflict of interest process, in terms of
send me
copy,
yeah,
of the email, perhaps through the chair,
yeah,
and then I'm more than happy to look at how you and how much you can respond to that.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you. Can I apologise to everybody? I'm afraid to spend half the day in the walking centre with somebody, which actually gave me the greatest service ever, and I would absolutely compliment the walking centre.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for asking me to come and speak to you about the issues that I want to present this afternoon. I've just passed my first anniversary as chair of Wirral's Safeguarding Children Board, which I think is moving in the right direction. It was critiqued by Ofsted in 2016 for being apparently far too close to the council and not a true partnership. So the changes that have been brought about by the 2017 Children and Social Work Act, which is what I want to review on, and then talk about some opportunities for better partnership working in the future and for making Wirral a very strongly child-friendly place to be and to grow up and to learn. I think it's opportune, is what I will say, the changes brought by the law. That's who I am. My background is in, I have been a director of children's services in Gateshead at the time of year, and from 2010 to 2015 I was Children's Commissioner of England, which is about the rights of the child and the best job in the universe. But it's limited by the statutory term, so I strongly support my successor's work in what she's doing as Children's Commissioner. The work continues like a stream. You get in the boat, so you've had the vote for a long run and have the vote for. So it's a fantastic job. And the principles that we're relying on in front of our child friendly communities across the country. So I'm going to talk about three broad themes: the Children's Social Work Act, which I referred to briefly a moment ago, the opportunities that are presented for the Health and Wellbeing Board as the one statutory body now. That has health and wellbeing under its purview, Children's Trust having been stood down by Michael Gove when he was Secretary of State, and children's issues and wellbeing needing a home that's not just about safeguarding, but about much bigger themes than that. And then a trailer for the new model of practice that's been adopted across agencies in the Wirral, which is called Supporting Families and Enhancing Futures, about which more in a while. So, this is what the 2017 Act has done. It gained royal assent just before the 2017 election, and it abolishes the Local Safeguarding Children Board. Now, they were, you will remember, set up under the 2004 Children Act, and they were set up as a result of the then government's belief that the existing area child protection committees were very narrowly focused and didn't look at prevention or early intervention or keeping children safe before things get to crisis point. Their founding was also driven, at least in part, by some of those crisis points, not least in that case, the very tragic and horrific death of Victoria Tunde, and the Laming Inquiry that led to the 2004 Children Act, which itself followed the paper Every Child Matters, which was an 03 green paper. The Act abolishes those safeguarding boards, but what it doesn't do is let anybody off the hook in terms of their safeguarding duties, which will remain a legal requirement. It's just that there won't have to be a board. There will, however, need to be a partnership of some sort. Multi-agency safeguarding arrangements is what DfE are calling them. We are wondering about something like the Rural Integrated Safeguarding Partnership or some such. There will only be three, and they're stressing the Act is equal statutory partners. And they are the local authority, which will probably remain the host body, the police, and the CCG element of the health economy. However, if you're a relevant agency, that means you're a school, an FE college, a nursery, a children's centre, a doctor's surgery, a health provider of any sort at all, a mental health trust, or whatever else you are, and you've already got safeguarding duties, they will remain in place. Now, the opportunity there is that if you've got a strong core of those three statutory bodies, and then everybody else is at the table because they want to be, and because they take their safeguarding duties really seriously, the chance for a borough like Borough to really move forward on delivering the 20 by 20, on delivering on each other's promises to each other and holding each other to account without the big stick of a legal framework that demands that you're there. That's very much what Eric and others in the council are interested in and enthused about. His line being, if you force people to the table because it's a statutory requirement, sometimes they come unwillingly. If you bring them to the table because goodwill pertains and people want to do the best for children and people, you get further. And I think there's a lot to commend in that. There will be a change to the Child Death Overview Panel system and the sudden and unexpected death in childhood arrangements, in that they will move at national level from the DfE to the Department for Health, and at local and regional levels, we expect the strengthening of the Child Death Overview Panel, probably chaired by Mike Leaf on a panel nurses side basis, but the oversight will be with health. Nobody's saying where the money's coming from, nobody's saying whether we're just going to stamp it all down elsewhere and expect us to do it on fresh air, because very sadly some of these arrangements have been played back to the sector. There's been a very heavy consultation and about 800 responses, and it's been played back to the sector along the lines of, well, you decide. Now, there's strength in that. You tailor what you do to your place. Of course you do. And you do so very strongly in a place that has an identity as strong as rules. The danger in it is that when you expect 1,000 flowers to bloom, you have no idea how uniformly planted those flowers are or whether they're all going to grow. And if there is then a horror that occurs, like Victoria Kimbley or Daniel Parker or whoever else, will there then have to be a scramble to try and reconfigure things? And we don't know. But the child death arrangements are one to keep an eye on. This is the expected timetable. We were hoping that there would be parliamentary debate on the results of the consultation on the new Working Together to Safeguard Children draft guidelines that were issued last year in February. But unfortunately, the parliamentary timetable is very heavy at the moment, for obvious reasons, and therefore it will be at least May or June 2018 for full parliamentary debate and full parliamentary sign-off of the new document, which will then be a statutory framework, as our previous version has been. Following that deadline, that's the kind of wave of the starting flag. And there will be 12 to 15 months, we think closer to 15 than 12, to put in place the new arrangements and to stand down the local safeguarding children board as it currently operates in order to reconfigure and to create this new partnership. Many partners around the local safeguarding board table in the Wirral feel that we may take our eye off the ball if we go into radical, full-scale, health level change. Very particularly, health provider sector groups are saying we are taking our eye off the very important ball of getting better at safeguarding our children together as a partnership. But the DfE have made it very clear that they will not accept new arrangements with just the label changed and the arrangements themselves representing the status quo. Not from many local safeguarding board are certainly not from the representation of England. So there will need to be change. What partners are leaning towards is the least possible change, the least possible disruption that we can manage in the world. Until the new arrangement is in place, the LSCB remains the statutory body, which means that if it all stops on March the 31st, that's the date on which the LSCB closes down, and when everybody gets up on April the 1st, that's the point at which the new partnership takes over. There is no gap. So, here are some opportunities. I'm going to just pass round. I'm involved in a variety of places, and one of them is Rotherham. And they've worked with their children and people in Rotherham to do a reimagining exercise. They took over a derelict or an empty shop in the middle of the town, and they did a pop-up embassy for children and people to tell the adults in their town what they wanted from their place. And I think it's interesting, it's in its infancy, but the sort of things that Leeds has done, the sort of things that North Yorkshire has done, the sort of things that Brighton and Hove has done, Lincolnshire is similar, is very strongly about reconfiguring what you do with and for your children and your people by getting them to be your co-creators and your co-consultants, not just the adults and children or parents. So if we're going to develop a new safeguarding arrangement and there are only three statutory partners, who else sits in the next layer out from those three, and the next layer out from that, and the next layer out from that? And how do you, as a borough, and all the partners in it, create a child-friendly Wirral that will automatically work to keep its children safe, but also educated and healthy and active citizens who are less likely to be troublesome or challenging, troubled or challenged, because the borough works together to make sure that their lives continue to improve, especially in some of your more challenged and disadvantaged communities where there are obviously intergenerational difficulties in some children's lives that everybody needs to work together to address. Your new Director of Children's Services is a real enthusiast for helping all partners to work together to make Wirral into the best place possible for children to be born, to grow, to go to school, to learn, to play, to be housed, to abide by the law, and to be the next generation of parents who bring the next generation of children into being. It's long-term stuff and it's visionary stuff, but you have an opportunity, because the government is saying it's up to you how you choose to do it, you've got the opportunity. The issue for you as a borough is that you have maintained a Children's Trust Board, and therefore this board tends to be fairly light on priorities for children and young people. When Mr. Gove's Secretary of State, he considered that Children's Trust Boards created yet another layer of bureaucracy, and in some places that's absolutely the case. And he stood down the requirement for there to be a statutory partnership for children and young people. So at the moment, the only place where children and young people's issues are kind of held is at the local safeguarding children board. Which means that the body that's meant to hold you to account for what you do for children is carrying the priorities for children, and that's not appropriate. So my plea would be that the Health and Wellbeing Board steps into the space that says, we own this, these are our children, the safeguarding partnership is only part of that, the whole agenda for our children and people, in school, in college, in children's centres, in communities, in the streets, in the parks, belongs to us because it's about wellbeing. I think it's a fantastic opportunity. I stand ready to play my part for as long as is needed, but the actual role that I hold will be stood down alongside the board. So one of the really big decisions is, what's the relationship between the new partnership and this board? Who chairs the new partnership? Does it circulate around the three statutory bodies? Does it involve the relevant agencies as well? How do you ensure objectivity? How do you hold to account? And September 2019 might feel like a long way away, if you think about it, all the new arrangements are going to need to be consulted on. They're all going to have to go through every executive board of every partner agency concerned. the police and crime commission is going to have to get involved. You need to make sure that DfE is not going to send it back and say, no, you're right. You need to make sure that when Ofsted comes to inspect SEN and disabilities, the fact that children and new people are part of that doesn't interrupt your development of a new partnership. September 2019 begins to feel a bit like the week next Wednesday, really. So Eric and Paul and Ian Hassel and Simon from the CCG are working now, I think, to try to get around the table and work out what a new theme ought to look like and what its relationship should be to this board. And should it be a subset of this board? Should it report to you so that you can actually keep tabs on what's happening for children and people? And if so, what does that look like and what's the governance structure and who manages risk and who pays for it, who carries liability and so on? It's complex change, and the same people who are sitting at the board table now and the same people who sit here when you're a bit more quarry than you are this afternoon will actually be the people who are trying to do this change all at the same time. So it isn't going to be simple and it needs to be right, and Eric is really clear, right, not rapid. So he's really keen that we take a lot of time and we go out a lot to talk to people and we get invited to boards and senior discussion tables in your organisations. Because this has got to be done right, it's got to be done right for children. I'm just going to trail this. As I arrived, this model, Supporting Families Enhancing Futures, the least handy acronym in creation, which is SFEF, was being developed, guided and helped by Emeritus Professor Jan Haworth, who's been a professor at a variety of universities and is currently, I think, at Sheffield. It's very, very strongly research-based, is SFEF, and it has been developed by a multi-agency team. So schools have been involved, years professionals have been involved, health colleagues have been involved. It is not just social workers sitting in a dark room and coming out of it with a diagram that says, use this. It's been in place since October, and all the agencies that are on the safeguarding board have signed up. It started in child protection, it's moving into child in need, early health, the multi-agency safeguarding hub, and other practice. It's very strongly about doing with the family, not doing unto the family. So if you were in a child protection conference running under this model, we would be seated in a horseshoe. You wouldn't always sit around the table with a pile of papers waiting for the family to come in, but everybody enters the room together. And you are all facing a wall that's lined in flip chart paper. And one section is red, the middle section is amber, and the next section is green. And you and the family work together on what's going on in their lives that is so dangerous that it moves to their right. What since the last time has moved from red into amber, and what since the last time has moved from amber into green? And they are as strong a driver as you are as a set of professionals of what everybody thinks is actually happening in the story of that family. It's very strong on story work, on working out what the family's journey has been to get to a place where they need additional help. There's masses and masses of professional training material. The innovations are very strongly driven by recording and finding a way of celebrating the lived experience of the family where there are strengths, however few there may be in a family that's in real crisis. It's only been in operation since October. It was very formally launched in November, and families are already saying, we understand it, we get it. Families are already saying, you think it's moved from amber to green, we think it's still amber, leave it where it is. And it's the family that helps you to decide whether or not things are moving at the right pace, and it's the family that helps you to decide what extra help is still needed. And families have said things like, we're all facing in the same direction, and you've made me look up. Do not underestimate when a family that's in crisis or in difficulty says that. It's a fantastic model, it's getting national notice. People are getting onto the Safeguarding Board website and using it. They're crediting us because it's copyright, but they are using it. So places that have actually got better Ofsted grades than the LSCB in this borough are saying back to me as chair, this is fantastic material, how do we get hold of it? Are you offering training? So those are the five key principles that underpin it. You understand, you very deliberately go in and understand the world of the child. And if the child is very young or non-verbal, you can use drawings, you can use simple assisted communication, you can get them to draw what they think of their family life, you can get them to think about what they want to say. But at the same time, you're there to understand the world of the adults, including grandparents, those who've got special guardianship orders, people who are doing kinship care, extended family members, blended family members. You very deliberately set out to record what the strengths are. Because actually, even families in really great crisis, one of the things that they'll say is, but we love our children. And children will acknowledge that. Where are the strengths, even if they're small, and how do you build on them? You actually engage the families in the change process, and you help them to set targets for what needs to change next, or what needs to improve next. And then you measure the change through those regular meetings. Social workers are saying, this is real social work. You can use the Get Graded Care Profile as part of the toolkit that you use when you go in to do a SPEF process. And I'm training it this afternoon because we'd like to come back and talk to you again when we've done some evaluation. We think it is potentially groundbreaking stuff. When I arrived last January, it was just about to be made to go live. And the reason why you chose to do it was because you didn't have any on world practice. You had this group over here doing it like this, and this group over here doing it like that, and this group over there reinventing something else altogether, and these people over here thinking, well, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. There is now a model, and it's not going away, and training is rolling and constant. And if you get onto our website, you'll find all the materials. You'll find the threshold document for the right services, right time materials that is highlighted in the bottom right-hand side of that slide. We think the board has come a long way. It's now very active on Twitter. It puts out materials, it puts out comments, it reminds people that there are important days. So it reminds people of things like Young Carers Day or Young Carers Week or Foster Fortnight or Adoption Week. It's really important that we are out there and present because young people particularly tend to live online. So do follow us. I'm talking to the League about the possibility as we move towards this changed arrangement for the Health and Wellbeing Board to review its priorities and to review its plans so that children and people find a home, a deliberate choice to have strong children's priorities as part of your business. From all agencies, because Ian Hassel, if he were here, would also talk to you about the work that they do, the police does, with children and people, and the Safeguarding Board features ambulance service, fire and rescue, health work, commissioning and providing, schools, nurseries, their feed colleges, housing providers, the voluntary sector, all sit at that table. And they're all about the well-being of children and people in your borough. So, thin on the ground as you may be this afternoon, if all you do is take home with you how people can get onto our website and start to interact with those materials, and we will come back and talk again about where things are at. And Paul Boycewood, I know, really want to pick your brains on what any new model starts to look like, because he can't do his job without it. So that is a real cooked tour of what we do as the board, and where we're going next, and where we might go next, and where the uncertainties as well as the challenges and opportunities come from. And Chair, if you have any questions, I'd be delighted. And I need those roller materials back, but do send them around.
Thank you very much for that, Maggie. Any questions or comments? Esther?
As the presentation went on, I began to wrestle with the idea that I need to declare the interest as a member of the improvement board that was set up to look at matters to improve practice for social work for children. However, Maggie has made these presentations, and each time we see it, it's a development of what is being sought. I've been perhaps long in the tooth. I'm wondering about what I call the basics. And what I'm want to establish is when, with this period of 18 months of change, restructuring and so on, that there's still the ability to keep a core of staff with the experience to look at cases and things, to carry out reviews when things haven't gone well. That's the heart of the original work. Also trying to work out where there's a place, what I used to call the youth service, but it's quite cold now, the people working in response, the people working out at Pilgrim Street, because they, to me, would seem to have a key role in this. And I haven't quite seen how that fits in with Maggie's thoughts at the moment. In general, because of SFEF has become a topic of great interest, and where the school governors have, I know that it can change from CAF and TAF and all the other stuff, and that there's a stronger link between schools and then social workers, which is helpful. So clearly we're working down to schools, and spreading information between schools and social services is better. The children's services, I'm going to say, now that the emphasis is to be on hearing the voice of the child and ensuring that social workers compile reports that do that and have a common basis for the reports, and the reports then read by others mean the same thing to the people at the region. That's the sort of things that have been going on over the last 18 months. I raise one or two queries about now a core of staffing and the role of the youth service, as I call it, and perhaps we have Maggie's comments on that, please.
By all means, Chair, and the Improvement Board meets once a month, and it was a requirement by DfE on the borough to set it up, and it only looks at the very, very tiny slice of what you do for children in social care. Because that's all STEM looked at. It didn't look at what's happening in community services and youth services and youth offending team and young carers and barnarders. It looked at a very, very narrow slice, and the Improvement Board has honed its thinking so that it too is only looking at that very, very narrow slice. You have 74,000 under 18s in this borough, and the vast majority of them never meet a social worker because they never need one. And what it seems to me the next stage of your journey is, and we said this last Improvement Board, is to get to the place where social work, which is absolutely vital if a child is in crisis or a family is in real difficulty, takes its rightful place, which is at that very far end of the continuum of what you do. And preventative work, and you're absolutely right, Councillor Gilchrist, youth services, outreach services, services of communities, the work of your library and cultural and leisure services, and all of those teams contribute to the life chances and the well-being of your children, and can keep them out of the doctor's surgery and specialist health teams as well, done right. And you get more mums who are problem-free if you can actually get upstream of when problems actually begin. So, for me, the next 18 months is your opportunity to go back to that very broad vision that was in Every Child Matters. How healthy are your children? How safe are your children? How well are they both enjoying and achieving in your schools and other education settings? How well are they having their voices heard